It's wonderful having your life's work done, especially when it's something you just love to do. Thank you, ICA, and thank you to all the people who along the way made this moment possible.
My name is Denise Gainey, I'm the current president of the ICA, and I have my colleague Kip Franklin here, who is our treasurer, and we're very excited today to get to honor a very important clarinetist, Ted Johnson. And thankfully, his son is able to be here, and he's going to talk a little bit about his dad. But what a wonderful time to be able to gather in person and have some of his students play to honor him and the many contributions he made as a player and as a mouthpiece maker and all of those things. So we're so grateful and thankful to have all of you here today to share in this celebration of a wonderful man. So I'd like to present this honorary membership to Ted Johnson. We will, at the awards ceremony on Saturday night, also be reading a full bio and make sure people know more about him as well there. But we're going to start today with letting you talk about your dad, some, and I wanted to give this to
great.
You.
Great. Thank you very much.
Please give your dad a hug.
My dad got his start in Chicago on the south side in 1939. His parents were looking for a reason to get him out of street gangs, which were popular back then. And back then, I think Benny Goodman went to his high school. So in those days, the clarinetist was like the lead guitarist. They kind of shared it with the trumpet player, so that was a cool thing to do, and that's what he did. He was an only child. He practiced his butt off and found that he was good at it and achieved acclaim doing it. And then he worked his way up through the Chicago Youth Symphony, then went to Kansas City Philharmonic, as it was called back then, and that's where I was born. He met my mom there. And, you know, the guy back then in those seasons where they had, 12-week seasons, you had to fill a calendar up, so he worked landscaping jobs and substitute teaching and, you know, you name it, to make ends meet. And then an opening came up in Cleveland where George Zell was the conductor. And that's one of my dad's favorite stories as to how he was selected. I think back in those days, they probably didn't have blind screenings or anything. He just got up there, and my dad was right in the middle of a couple hundred clarinetists. And my dad got done playing, and George Zell said, "That's it, stop, cancel them all. That's the guy I want." So he played with, and when they put him up on stage, they put him with Bob Marcellus, who was the first chair back then, who I used to cut his yard as a kid. And Bob was a great guy, a really warm-hearted person. But his job was to take off running and see if my dad could support and follow him, and that's what he did. Threw him loops left and right, changed his tone, his tempo, you name it. My dad just, you know, in addition to his superb tone himself, he was a great follower and was able to support very well. I know he'd like to be here. He's 92. He's in good shape. He's still living in Cleveland, but 92 is 92, and it's a tough trap. So I can answer any questions anybody might have about him. I didn't have a big spiel prepared. I'm a recovering attorney, so you give me a microphone and I'll go forever. There's no questions, I'll let the show get on. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, Ken. I was very honored when Ted asked if I would play for this program, and I decided, well, what do you play to honor the greatest E-flat player there otherwise? So I decided we need to play something on the E-flat clarinet, for better or for worse. So I chose the Carnival of Venice, which actually most of us heard for the first time in our fifth grade band books, some little tune, but it came from Naples, Italy. It was a folk tune, and then the famous violinist Niccolo Paganini took the tune and wrote 20 variations on it, and he felt like this was his greatest thing that he'd ever written. And then the clarinetist Paul Jean-Jean, who we know for the intricate clarinet etudes, took the tune, Carnival of Venice, and made a variation on it. And then might wonder, why is this part of the Ted Johnson tribute? It's because when I did my artist diploma at the Cleveland Institute with Ted Johnson, I made all his reads. And it was a blessing for me because I was destitute, and this is how I paid my rent every month. I went to Northwestern University for my bachelor's and master's, and it was a new fad to make clarinet reeds. Clark Brody was the former principal of the Chicago Symphony, and he thought, this was a great thing. Everybody should make their own clarinet reeds from tube cane here. And then I was studying with Larry Combs, and he said, yes, I'm going to try to make my own. And Robert Marcellus said, oh, my, we should all make our own clarinet reeds. So Northwestern purchased a reed dual. It's D-U-A-L, not D-O-A-L-L. And we had a reed room, and we actually could take a class. Mr. Brody taught a class, and I had a class with Larry Combs. So it was a long time ago, but I had some pretty good success initially making reeds. A lot of my friends were like, oh, that's too much trouble. It's too expensive. I'm going to sell my do-all. So I got the do-all for half price and a cartridge bag for $25, which lasted me until just a few years ago.
Wow.
So let me see a show of hands. Anybody here make their own reeds? Anybody interested in making reeds? Okay, all right. Well, this is the process. I'm going to go through it here quickly for you. But you can start with the tube cane. I'll send this around so you can see it. Then you split the cane, you quarter it, and then you have to have a planer to flatten it out because it's still a tube. And then you make a blank. Or if you want to make it a little bit simpler to start, there are a number of good sources where you can start with just the blank. Skip all this stuff. So I will show you, if you want to pass that around, I can take a look. And hope the equipment will work properly for us. If anybody's interested, you can just see what tube cane looks like. The oboe players all think this is really funny to see such. I have a lot of friends here, oboists. If you want to make your own reeds, become good friends with your oboists. So the equipment that I have, it's a planer and a shaper. I'll just send all of these around too. I'll just start somewhere else. This is the shaper here. I had somebody custom make the shaper when I was starting out. And then this is the planer. You can just pass that around if you like. Which is the equipment that makes the reed flat. So, and you can just start that around too if you want. There are a number of sources for reed equipment. I think if you're just starting out and you're very serious about making your own reeds, you can actually do this with commercial reeds as well. But I think this source here, the clarinet reed making, if you just Google that, there's a very nice overview of the machines, the different types of machines that are out there these days. And if you're not totally invested in making your own reeds from scratch, you can actually adjust the commercial reeds very nicely with some of these machines. So I don't know. I'll leave that up there if you want to take a picture. So this is my blank. And so I've gone through the whole process to make my own blank. Feel free to ask questions as we go. So I'll be around afterwards if you have questions too. So the first thing we need to do is to make a little mark. We measure, I think, 32 millimeters here. And then we make a scribe. This is the scribe. And then we strip the bark off, like so. My good friends who helped teach me how to do this. This is like peeling a banana. So it gets to be a little bit messy. So this is how I do the homemade blanks. And I get it down pretty thin. So I won't go ahead and finish it here, but I get it down pretty thin, and then I put it on the do-all. So if you would like to try a commercial blank, which I find find they're a lot thinner. This little piece of equipment is called a micrometer. There are some that are a lot simpler to use than digital ones, but the thickness of the cane is extremely important. I don't know if you can tell what that is, but I like to have mine about 30 micrometers or a little bit thicker. Actually, I've gone up to 4 occasionally, but the thickness is crucial. So we have now our bocce blanks, commercial blank there, and the first thing we need to do is make sure it's completely flat on the back. But we can't sand it too much because it's very critical about the thickness. So the ones I have here are actually only about 3 micrometers. So I take some plexiglass. Everybody have one of these they use for their reeds. It's imperative that you have a flat position. And then this is 400 sandpaper. I start with the 400 on the commercial blanks. I usually use 320 if I'm doing my own blank because it's quite a bit thicker and I need to get a lot more off. So we just start with the old, this is the least fun part about making reeds, the sanding, and the fingers tend to slip off and then you sand your fingers. So there are different ways to do this. But the main thing is that you get the back completely flat. So we do a little sanding with the 400. With Mr. Brody one time, my friend and I were working on reeds, and she found this really cool trick. So the sandpaper, and you've got a little bit of use on it. All you have to do is take your paintbrush, and you just gotta wipe that off, and it's like new. And she said, well, we can save on sandpaper. And Mr. Brody said, well, how much does it cost anyway? But you know, when you're a student, you know, every little bit. So there we go. So I always use my paintbrush to get a little bit of the sand off. You extend the life of your sandpaper. So now we've done the 400, and then I go down to the 600. So everybody familiar with sandpaper? Okay, there are all sorts of things you can use on your reeds, but I found the most success with the sandpaper. So then, never done this. Definitely not in my heels. So then the way to check to make sure that it's completely flat, see, hold it up to the light, and then if you see, I don't know if you can see here, but it should be completely shiny. If you look at this, is it showing up at all? There's a little bit of dullness right along in here. So, which means this is not having contact with the sandpaper. So we need to sand a little more for the sake of the class. We may just go ahead and move on, but you really shouldn't go to the next step until it's completely flat. And then I use a mill bastard file, which actually actually buy these still? Has anybody seen Duvall's, Reduvall's? Okay. They have a new improved version of them. Anybody use the new improved version? They have a vacuum cleaner attachment because it makes a little bit of dust, but my husband probably would like that because I get the kitchen really dusty. This is actually a vacuum cleaner belt. Goes on like so. I think the most challenging part of reed making is getting it all set up. Not so much all the sanding and the measurements, but getting it set up just exactly right. So there are some gauges here. This says harder, softer, and it works on the principle of a key duplicating machine. Now my model, you'll notice, is quite old. And actually had an oboe player friend of mine years ago in Cleveland, and we had a bet, you know, I couldn't make an oboe reed, she couldn't make a clarinet reed. Well, this is actually the clarinet reed she made. And there's nothing particularly special about it, but it didn't really play very well. But it's been a great model all these years. So the dimensions, I feel, are more important. So when you use the model, the main thing you have to remember is that the model must be thinner than your blank. Otherwise, it will never work out. So I have my commercial blank. I've sanded it so it's completely flat. And then I put it on here. Sometimes I'll take some of the bark off, even though a good deal of the bark in the cane is already removed when you get the commercial blank. So then you turn it on. It makes a little noise. I'll tell you first what I'm going to do. I start at this end here, and ideally we measure about 32 millimeters to make a scribe mark. And I start down here, and I'm going back and forth this direction, and not pushing at all. And I'm just letting this guide against the model here.
And then I use the dilutus machine. So
know Robert Duluth? He is in Maryland, other part of the country. He is a super guy. I actually just met him on Zoom last week. I was having a small issue with the machine. I emailed him thinking with a question, thinking, well, maybe he'll get back to me in a few days. Well, within 10 minutes, he responded. We went back and forth with my question, and then we were not able to resolve it. So he said, if you're free, let's Zoom. So we did. And I can't tell you, he was just so accommodating and helpful to me. So we have the model here. We have the blank here. And then this dial right here starts with it usually at the top. Again, these measurements are quite critical when you're starting out. This can be the most frustrating point, is getting used to, you know, the settings. So obviously less is more, so go slowly. This, what the little dial there does is actually push this bar out onto the model, so it traces the shape of the model. So just start very slowly, and I'm not really pushing much at all. It turns a little side to side, and then I do a little bit, like a millimeter. So with this dial here, has a little arrow. So I just go very slowly, and again, the handy dandy paintbrush to get the little pieces out from there, just so I'm getting a good cut. So still nothing yet. Continue on until this goes around 9 o'clock. I had a friend who just plays commercial reeds, and we tried one of his heavy commercial reeds with this, and it worked beautifully. So if you want to say you're playing on 4 reeds, if you want to buy like 4.5, it works really nicely. So then you get a little more cane in the heart. So it's just starting to take off a little bit right now, and my dial is about around to maybe 7 o'clock. Can you see that it's starting to take off some more right here now? You can look. I can't see here. You see this shaving is right there. So this is where I be very careful. Again, I'm running over the entire reed right now. But as we get closer to the finish, I'll only go part way to about right here. I kind of stay away from the tip and the heart. Mr. Marcellus used to give summer classes at Northwestern, and one summer Mr. Rody gave a class on reed making, and there was a guy in the audience, I'll never forget this, he had a question, and Mr. Rody said yes, and the guy said, well, what could be happening with my do-all if it catches on fire every time? I was like, what? No idea. Mr. Rody was speechless. All right, so now the dial is up here, maybe around 10 o'clock, and I'm going to take it off and see how it sounds. You can tell that it's actually shaped a little bit more. It's a little thinner here in the corners. I'll go in a little more. So from this point on, I start testing it, because you can ruin it with just a little bit too much off of which area?
The heart.
Still extremely heavy. So, take a little bit more off. bottle is critical that's a little bit thinner than the blank.
Lessons.
TIF, and you can also use the back of the sandpaper, the non-abrasive side, and I just completely, if you're very careful with the TIF, completely go over the entire thing. So while this is breaking in, maybe over a period of a week, I will do this every day to the reed, and very, very judiciously. Other thing, reed knives. Anybody have reed knives? Clarinet players don't use, have, know how to use them. This is a John Furlow, he's a voice in Boston. He made the most simple reed knife. It's a single bevel, and it comes with a sharpener, has a guide, so you know anybody can use it. You can have a reed knife that's sharp all the time. One last thing. So if you're using your reed knife, there are two strokes. One is the snow plow, like so. I'm just doing the back of the reed because it won't matter that much. And the other is the scoop. So the scoop is when we're scooping. You can use that on the sides of the reed, like so. If you have any questions, I'm sorry we're running out of time, but I'll give you my email. Yes?
What is a blank cost?
That's a really good question. They cost anywhere from 25 cents to maybe $3 per blank. But most of them are around a dollar or so. RDG Woodwinds sells them. Again, these are some places where you can get blanks and reed supplies. Anything else? One last thing that you can do to shape the tip. This is horrifying for most clarinetists when they see me do it, but I never use a reed trimmer. I just shape the tip. So I've taught students to do this. The only thing you have to do is keep your left hand very still. And I take the sides off, and this is so much less than the clipper. You know, you look at that reed trimmer and it takes a hump off. But I play concerts on square reeds and flutes, and I don't do this because I'm pretty well finished. But the main thing is, you can't let it bounce around like this. You hold this hand very steadily, and you can shape the tip. Okay.